rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We'll rejoice and be glad in it. We'll rejoice and be glad in it.
There's a joy that overwhelms our souls, cause we know our God is in control.
Morning, church. It's going to be a thing every week now. It's good to see you guys. Everyone have a good Thanksgiving?
Yeah.
Yes? Like the people right here, but nobody else? That's kind of what I gathered from there.
All right, awesome.
Why don't you guys go ahead and take a second, stand back up, and greet one another. Find someone you don't know. Shake hands with them.
Good morning to everyone that's joining us on Facebook today. We are so happy that you're here in this place with us this morning.
Good morning.
So this Wednesday for the teens, all right, this is a youth thing. We have the youth Thanksmas, all right. It's from 6 to 8 on Wednesday. It's like a regular Wednesday night, just starts a little earlier, all right. We're going to have a meal for the teens, and we're going to have a white elephant afterwards. It's going to be an awesome time, all right. I'm making food, so it's going to be good, and there's going to be a white elephant, all right. Hey, it's going to be good, all right. It's going to be good. So that's this Wednesday, 6 to 8.
Fifth and sixth graders are also invited to Thanksmas. They are more than welcome to show up with our teens and start integrating themselves into our youth group. Coming up in two Sundays on December 10th, we have our children's Christmas program. And if you would like to invite someone that you know, there are invites on the check-in desk out there. It says welcome right on front of it. And you're more than welcome to grab a couple postcards and give those to family or friends or whoever you want to be there that Sunday.
Ladies, this one is for you, all right? Woo! Ladies St. Charles shopping trip on December 2nd. Wish I could be there, but I can't. I'm not a lady. You guys are leaving at 8:30 on December 2nd, and you'll return around like 6, all right? That's probably rough. I bet you guys are going to be out so late. Wish I could be there.
Starting next next Sunday for the children's ministry again, we are having a book drive in the month of December. So as you guys are getting new books for your children or giving somebody new books, if they have any old books for nursery up to 5 years old, they're more than welcome to bring them here and put them in our bookshelf. We're trying to fill that up for our early childhood classroom.
All right, we are having a Jeff Simmons Christmas card shower. All right, there's a little box out there. And if you can't read the fine print, which I can barely read the fine print here, it says, Jeff is Tony Simmons' brother and is on a Navy ship in Israel. Let's help him have a great Christmas. There we go. So you can get a card, and there's a box out there that you can drop it in. Do that by December 10th, and it'll go to him.
Also right next to the Christmas card box, there is a big links poster, and over there has more information, but we are raising money for missionaries in Africa. So if you would like to be a part of that giving this season, you can stop over there. If you have any questions, please contact Kathleen for that.
All right, y'all, let's party for God this morning.
Have a wonderful Sunday.
Woo, and man, I was realizing on December 2nd, we will take tip cups out and we will wrap gifts at the mall because the wives are all shopping. And that will allow us to cover those expenses. I'm just kidding. Stand and party with us as we continue to worship Christ.
Every heart.
over a city a long time ago. All these lights remind us of the excitement to come. A baby to be born that would change the world, amen. Deer hunting in Wisconsin and came home with all the tags in my pocket. But God is so good to me. Sat there enjoying his nature, spending time with family, sitting around a table full of more food than most people get in a year. Blessed. Shared in an Eagle Court of Honor for a young Boy Scout. And heard another teen from his church walk up and say, "This young man made a difference in my life for Christ." That's what it's about. This season is full of hope. It's full of peace. It's full of joy. What are we doing as individuals? What is Tim Tripp doing right now that every person he encounters will walk away from him with more hope, with more joy, and with more peace than they walked up to Tim with? What am I doing each day to say, "Lord, great are you, Lord. You give us life, and I want to share that with someone else." Amen.
Heart that is
God's people said.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. As our ushers prepare to take tithes and offerings, let's prepare our hearts to be in line with what God wants. Maybe to be restored, renewed, maybe just to spend time with Him. As we always say, the altars are open, but we know God can meet you right where you're at. If you're joining us online, maybe it's turning around on your couch, your seat, and kneeling before Him. But all that really matters is bowing our hearts, honoring Him, and listening for His voice. Let's seek God this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for this morning. We thank You for this season of gratitude, this season to be thankful. You are a God that loves us, not because of anything we do. We can't earn Your love. We can't lose Your love. God, this morning, may we be thankful of that. May we recognize that. May we understand that. May we give You all praise because of that. This morning, we lay all our burdens at Your feet. All our hurts, our brokenness, all our habits that are not healthy and keep us down. We lay them at Your feet. May You handle them. May You help us with them. May You pull us out of the sin in which we are easily captured into. Lord, I pray that You surround us with people that will love us, that will encourage us, that will cheer us on in this race of life. May we find friends that are based in Your love. May today be an opportunity that we are Your servants. We understand the mission that You have put on our heart, and we go out there in this world with a sense of passion, of understanding how much You love us, and You've called us to love others the same way. Lord, may we understand that. May we say yes to that today. And may we do this all with a thankful heart. May this morning be just a morning where we come to draw closer to You and worship You. May Your words be heard. May You put everybody else to the side. May You put me to the side. May people hear Your word and not me this morning. We give You all the praise. Amen. Ushers. Psalms 107:1 says this: Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. As I preach this morning, as I give the word of God this morning, I pray and I hope that you keep this in mind as I go along. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. May it resound, may it something that, you know, you don't hear my voice anymore. But this starts to reign, this starts to rule. This scripture, these two lines in my Bible in Psalms 107 becomes overwhelming to a point that His love endures forever is true, that is meaningful, that helps you understand that you have a reason to give thanks because His love endures forever. Welcome. We are so happy to have you here this morning. I hope and pray that you have had a great Thanksgiving. Maybe some of you still have a Thanksgiving meal to have today, and that maybe next week too you still have in celebrations of Thanksgiving and meeting family. I hope that you have eaten a lot. I hope this morning that you're struggling at staying awake because it means you ate so much, not because you slept poorly last night, right? And not because I'm boring. Who knows? It might be all three of those, but I'm going to go that you had too much turkey, all right? Just for my own heart, all right? I see. Oh, there we go. All right. Your Thanksgiving was boring is what I'm going to take that as, all right? That's how I roll. I'm not going to keep myself up late at night for this one going, oh, man, they fell asleep, all right? But we are still continuing on our attitude of gratitude. It is that one weird Sunday in between Thanksgiving and Advent, and we start Advent next Sunday. And I want you to know, first off, growing up and still today, I have a child heart. I love this season. Even though it means that it's cold and it's rainy and it's kind of gross outside. And as an adult, you just go, oh, that's horrible in some ways because I have to get up early and I have to shovel and I have to deal with all the slush. And by February, you're like, man, it's the worst. I hate Illinois. I hate the roads. I hate the gray slushiness. Anybody else? Okay, we're all on board. So we've got something in common. By February, we're all thinking, man, Florida sounds nice. Hawaii sounds nice, right? Maybe we take a group mission trip in February. Costa Rica, here we come in February. Can we do it earlier? Is that? Yeah, right? Sounds like a plan to me, selfishly. But like, I know for me, I am excited for Advent. I'm excited for the anticipation of us being able to celebrate the birth of our Savior and what that means. But this morning, we don't do that. But we do. Because we should always be in the preparation of understanding that we have been in the presence of Jesus Christ on this world. That He has come, that He has restored us, that He continues to restore us. And then that changes our whole attitude to understand why we should be grateful. Sermon done. Go home. All right. No, I'm just kidding. I got 54 more minutes. Yeah, you're going to be hungry. All right? No, I want to rehash some things that we talked about last week. And I don't want a show of hand. I don't want to, like, maybe you weren't here last week, and that's good that you get an opportunity to hear what I think is the motor of changing our attitudes and how we can change our attitudes by asking three questions. And it might not work for everybody, but I feel like we can't go wrong by asking and actually giving inventory. Like actually writing it down, actually taking notes and going, this, number one question, is how I loved God this week. Not how God has loved me, because we know. Most of us know God loves me, right? We even talked about it in a couple seconds ago. He sent His Son to live and breathe as one of us because that's how much He loves us, all right? We know. Right, and some of you might not know clearly. You might not, maybe you're on the fence. I'm praying that through interaction with us, interaction with God, you see how God loves us, right? My question, I think we, in order to adjust our attitude, to adjust to understand what we have thanks to give, even though life might be misery, is knowing how I have loved God this week, all right? I think is an essential question. Within our development of disciples, yes, you are called to be disciples of this nation. You are called to be followers of Jesus Christ. And in that, we have to know how we love God. We can't just walk aimlessly and hoping God will lead us and go, okay, I'm here. And it doesn't work that way necessarily. We have to be actively looking for ways to love our Master, to love our Creator, all right? I think it's important for us to be intentional in our relationship with God. I don't think it's something that we should take lightheartedly. All right? Second question. God created you, right? He knows every hair on your head. He knows the freckles. He knows the imperfections of you. He loves you so much. He spent time creating you. Sometimes it's so hard for us to love ourselves. Do you know that He has called you to love yourself? Not to hate what you are, not to hate what you become, because we understand that Jesus has come and He has redeemed us. He has forgiven us. His grace is sufficient. Do you understand that? His grace is sufficient for you today. Not just yesterday. Not just last minute. Not that last time that you sinned. He loves you today, this moment, this breath. He shows His grace. He showers His grace upon you. That's how much He loves you. He's waited at every bated breath of showing you how much He loves you. You are called to love yourself. Now, we can look at this world and go, okay, there's a lot of people that love themselves. I would beg to differ, because if they don't know who God is, they don't really understand what it means to love themselves the way God has designed them to love themselves. It's not meaning you're putting yourself on a platform. It doesn't mean that you pamper just yourself. It means you forgive yourself of all the wrongdoings that you have ever done, and you don't let those bounds of chains of sin rest there anymore. You don't have to be the whipping child of those sins anymore. That you understand Jesus has forgiven you, and you want to live that forgiven life out. That's loving yourself. We talked about writing that down, taking those notes of how you've loved yourself this week. And I love it, like the great commandment is this. If you remember, right, we talked about this, what the great commandment is. And if we don't need the rest of the commandments if we follow this one great commandment. Those 10 commandments that we have, you know them? So, know of them, all right? They're there in Scripture, right? Maybe search them up. But I'm going to tell you, if you follow the first, which is aided by one other sentence, if you follow these commandments, you don't need the rest of them, because they just fall in line. If you love God, love yourself, and you love others as yourself. How have you loved others this week? How have you shown that, hey, I don't care, you don't have to do things for me, you don't have to speak a certain way for me, you don't even have to act a certain way for me, I just love you. Because God has loved me. And that same grace that's waited upon me is shown upon them. Right? Now I think when it comes to the formula of like how to love God and how to love yourself, I think the easiest one for us to do, and sometimes it's prideful and it's boastful, is how to love others. Right? And we somewhat get it kind of confused, like, well, I didn't hit them today. Gold star. Right? I'm going to tell you, no. That's not the gold star, and it's not about getting a gold star, and it's not about not hitting somebody. It's actually going the extra mile and the extra moment and turning the other cheek. See, it's not easy. And what I love about Scripture and what I love about our relationship with God is all the three things of these, love God, love yourself, and love others, we can't do them alone, because we can't do them by our own power. That power, that understanding, that way of life, guess where it's originated from, where we deviated from in the garden, is from God. And the only way that it can be restored in that moment of understanding how to love God and love others and love myself is if I allow that restoration to happen, to allow that original creation to sit here, to allow to understand God is the ruler here. And when I do love others and I love myself and I love God, it is attributed to the fact that I understand what God has done in my life. And I want to live that way. And I want that to be embraced by me. And not just embraced by me, but I want it to be my life. I want to be able to breathe this out. When I breathe in God, I want the exhale to be God and His Holy Spirit. I want Him to live in me. And the way those are lived in me is every moment, even if it's frustrating, even if I had a bumper collision this morning, even if I had an argument this morning, like those are going to come. Life is not easy. It's finding God in those uneasy moments, and maybe it's asking forgiveness, and maybe it's asking, you know, hey, I love you despite this. Right? And understanding, even through the hard trials of life, this is all last week, I can find gratefulness because of what God has done in my life. I'm not bound by the circumstances of this world. I'm free from eternity with God. Understand? So the bounds of this world are no longer chained to me. That's why we look so much different from the world. That's why we have so much hope that just people come to us, you're crazy. How can you have so much hope? Don't you watch the news? Don't you know what's going on? Yeah, I know God's in control. I know God's got my life. I'm not worried. Why worry? He created the birds. He created the fields. He's dressed them. Look how beautiful they are. And he loves me so much more. I have everything to be grateful for. But it's so easy to get that attitude mixed up. It's so easy to watch how it just is manipulated and twisted. And I wake up in the morning, and there's mornings I've woken up and I'm like, I don't know why I'm in an angry mood. I don't know why that my heart's not adjusted. I did devotions the night before, and I'm waking up and I just want to punch somebody. I want to strangle somebody. Don't talk to me until I have my coffee. Right? And even after I'm in coffee, it just made me more energized to be angry. And I come in my office and just kick the door, let Peg know it. She laughs at me, makes me more angry. Right? It just doesn't win. But we live in that. We understand that. This is what's amazing. God resides in that and loves me through that. And then makes something beautiful out of it. It's awesome. Changing my attitude is a spiritual development that I am going to implore that we need to learn and understand. Right? And I'm going to ask this question, and it is for nobody to answer because I want everybody to have a good, safe trip home. Do you know somebody that needs their attitude changed? Do not raise your hand. Husbands, want a good Christmas. All right? But do you know somebody that needs an attitude change? And my thought easily goes, yes. Right? It's so easy to go, yes, they need an attitude change. But when the mirror is in front of us, it is so hard to see the reflection of the attitude that we betray and not get behind defense. Well, and defend our attitudes. Well, so-and-so did this. So-and-so did this. So-and-so did this. And it just starts to be a pile of excuses, right? And it just, all suddenly, you can't see the mirror anymore of your reflection of bad attitude. You just see the excuses in which you go, we're justified. We're good. I can carry this stuff and go, this is why I be the way I be today. Right? And if you know the story of Jesus, he comes in and he wipes that away and he tells this away. And as I was preparing the sermon, as I was studying, I came across this story. Now, as I tell this, again, I want you to understand, what love endures forever? God's love endures forever. Do you believe that? Five of you. Do you believe that this morning? Does God's love endure forever? In all circumstances? Do you believe it? Because it's easy not to, especially in those moments, right? I'm going to tell you a moment that as I was reading this story, and I believe it's a true story. It is not during our time. It's not during the time in which school would have allowed some of the things in which I'm going to tell you about, but it's still such an impactful story, all right? But through this, as I was reading it, all I could hear is this verse. God's love endures forever. So I hope that you capture on to this idea as I tell this story, all right? And it's about a school. And mainly this classroom, and this is going to really get some teachers there to understand, maybe even superintendents, maybe even principals, maybe just parents in general, all right? Teachers, have you ever had a class, or do you know a class, you're like, man, I'll quit if I get them, right? Well, in this story, 2 weeks of this class had already gone through two teachers. They were done. They quit teaching altogether, and they were veterans. All right, this class was that bad. All right, and this young man out of college who was looking for a job. I already got a laugh on it. Yeah, good luck to him, right? But he's looking for a job, and he goes to their principal, and he's hurt. Like through the community, he's heard about this class of students and how horrible they are, and he actually asked for that group. And the principal goes, "Hold on a minute. Now you're right out of college. You're fresh." Like, I don't know if it's a smart idea to give you this class. We want to retain you for a while. We don't want you to just give up. We're still working on this class. And he looked at the principal, and this is what's amazing to me in this story. He prayed for a second. He goes, "Let me pray for a second. Let me take a moment." You know, how many times, I'm going to pause this story. How many times have you had a conversation with somebody in mid-conversation, you're like, "Let me pray about it." Like right in front of you, "Let me pray about this. Let me bring this before God because I understand the purpose and the rhyme and the reason that's going on here is important, and I want to include God in." Whew. That's a powerful point. That's a powerful point in that story. I think it needs to be more engaged in our life to understand, too. May even adjust our attitude to how we approach things if we take the moment to include God in them. Back to the story. He comes up and goes, "No, I honestly think this is what I'm supposed to do. Give me that class." First day in the class, he's talking to the students. You know, "Hey, I'm so-and-so. I'm your teacher this year." And immediately in the back, his name is Big Tom, and he's one of the students. And he's talking to his student, like fellow students. He's like, "I can take him. I can hurt him." And I guarantee you, it's one of those statements, you know, as a teacher, you probably heard, and you're like, "I'm going to ignore it. I'm just going to keep going." And he goes, "Hey, we're going to do some things different this year, all right?" And you know, they're still chattering, they're still being loud, they're kind of slowing down. He goes, "All right, different, I've heard this before." And he goes, "Listen, we're going to have some rules. Do you guys want to learn, right? I hope you want to learn, but I want you to set the standards here, looking at the students. So I want you to make up the rules. We need rules, don't we?" And he goes, and a lot of the students all suddenly said, "Yeah, we get to make those up?" And they just started making rules. You know, like, "Don't cheat, come on time, don't steal." And what was awesome is they finally came up with a list of 10 rules, right? And they all agreed upon it. This whole class agreed upon it. And all of a sudden, they had structure. Not because of what the teacher was putting before them, but because of what the students put before the teacher. And he allowed them to set the standard there, right? And that was cool. And all of a sudden, things were going good. And before they went on from that point, he goes, "Okay, so what's going to be the punishment?" Now, this is the part that you'll recognize this is not during our time. All right? And they said, "Well, we think if somebody breaks one of these rules, they deserve some slashes. They deserve some whips." All right? And what we're going to do is no coats. That's cheating. They will get 10 lashes if they break one of these rules. And the whole group agreed. All right? It's pretty intense rules. Like, that's not going to pass today's structure of school. All right? So, like, this is an older story that is happening here. Let me give you some context there. All right? And all the students agreed to this rule, and the teacher didn't come up with these rules, didn't come up with the punishment. The student body did. The classroom did. All right? And guess what? The next couple of days, they were great. Everything was going good. They were learning. They were intrigued. They were respectful. They weren't breaking their 10 rules. They were good students. Until one day, Big Tom breaks in, and he yells, "Who stole my lunch?" Now, one of the rules is don't steal. So the teacher got involved, and they did an investigation, and they found out it was little Timmy that stole the lunch. All right? And Timmy had to be brought up, and he even said, "Yes, I did it. I committed the crime. I broke the rule. I deserve the punishment. And little Timmy comes before the school, comes before the class. All right? Now, he begs to keep his coat on, and the teacher looks at him. You know what the rules that we've set here. You know the punishment in which is standard here. You got to take your coat off. And he agrees. So he starts to take his coat off, and instantly the teacher starts, you could probably read it in his eyes, he started regretting letting this kid take his coat off because he had no shirt on. Now back in my day, I'm a goofy kid, and I don't have a shirt on that day, I just have a coat because I was like, I don't want to take the time to go get my shirt, right? So the teacher asks him, kind of thinking about this, asks him, why don't you have a shirt on? And he goes, listen, my family's poor. We only have one shirt for me. And today my mom's washing it, so I wear a coat. And as he's taking his coat off even further, the teacher and everybody else starts to recognize this kid doesn't get to eat that much. You can see his rib bones. You can see his sunken stomach. And when he's bent over too, you could see the spine protruding in his back. And everything within this teacher is like, I do not want to give this punishment. But the moment that I give up giving this punishment, there's anarchy going to rule in this classroom, and everything will be unstructured, and all this good stuff that we've had for the last 2 days is going to be gone because there is no punishment. Now, if you show any kind of weakness, you're done, right? And he goes, I'm going to have to give you these 10 switches. I'm going to have to hit you 10 times. And out of the blue, Big Tom stands up. Big Tom stands up and he goes, listen, teacher, is there any chance, would you be willing to let me take those slashes for little Timmy? Teacher thinks about it for a couple minutes. He says, absolutely. Stands over little Timmy. Teacher starts the punishment on Big Tom's back. The third switch, and it breaks for some reason. His rod breaks, and the teacher just breaks down, weeping in his face, weeping into his hands. And as he looks up, that classroom doesn't have a dry eye in it. Everybody is bawling their eyes out because of what's happening up on front. Little Timmy turned around and hugged Big Tom's neck, thanking him for taking the punishment, asking him for forgiveness for taking his lunch, looking at him and says, this is a little boy in a junior high classroom saying, I will love you forever because of what you did here. This story is an amazing story because it's really our story. You see, Jesus, in all perfection, stepped out of that perfection and took our punishment. We don't deserve it. We don't deserve that protection. In fact, we deserve the punishment. We do. And we don't pay that price anymore. Instantly, little Timmy's attitude, he didn't even have a bad attitude, but his attitude changed to one of gratefulness. He probably still has to deal with starvation. He still probably has to deal with not being poor and all that. Like, his problems don't go away, but his attitude has changed for life because somebody stepped in for his punishment. Guaranteed, he is thankful, not just that day, but forever. And sees life as not what they have and what I don't have, but sees life for being this moment of sacrifice of going, there is a bigger reason to this. And I'm not bound to just be poor. I'm not just bound to be homeless. I'm not just bound to this poverty of life. I am bound to Big Tom, who loves me. I am bound to Jesus Christ, who spread out his arms and got him nailed to a cross for me. An attitude of gratitude can be seen in this. It changes everything of how we see this world. It changes everything of how we walk in this world. It changes everything of how we speak to each other, how we live out there. We should be looking for the little Timmies out in this world. We need to be the Big Toms. Do you understand? Doesn't that sound different from persecution to salvation? A different attitude of gratitude. Let me pinpoint you another place that's amazing in this story of the power of thanks. And in this, what endures forever? Come on, church. What endures forever? God's love, right? That's what we hold on to. Psalms 107, imprint that in your life this week. His love endures forever, right? Right here. Oh, yes, maybe. Philippians 4 through 13, all right? Let me give you context of what is going on. This is a letter to Philippians, and this is from Paul, and guess where he's at? He's in prison, all right? Now, I don't know about you. I've not been spending any time in prison lately. You know, the closest thing is probably being in trouble. I'm not going to say with who, right? But we've all had those moments where we're going, oh, man, I'm in the doghouse, whatever, right? But prison, I can just only imagine being worse. Like, I don't do crimes because I wouldn't want to go to prison. Now you're going to say, so you would do crimes if there wasn't punishment? I'm going to leave that there for you to figure out. No, I would not, hopefully. But if you do crimes, if you get caught, guess where you get to go? You get to go to jail, you get to go to prison, you get to live those lives. Well, Paul wasn't necessarily doing something that was horrifically wrong that implored imprisonment, but it was kind of wrong in that town, that area. Guess what he was doing? He was preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can you imagine going down and deciding, hey, I'm going to preach the gospel to this community, and they go, listen, stop or you're going to be arrested. And you go, what? I have the right to do that. And they arrest you. And you go to prison for speaking the truth, letting them know about Jesus Christ. Would you be willing to do that? Hold down to that. All right, that's for another sermon series, I guess. But this is the scenario that's happened here. And I want you to read this with me. You don't have to, like, voice it, but I want you to read it with me, right? And I want you to get the attitude that's going on here. Rejoice in the Lord always. Okay, that doesn't sound like he's in prison. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Okay, that doesn't sound like the prison that I would probably be in. I'd be going, Lord, get me out. I'm anxious. I'm looking behind my back at every second. Lord, help me. Prison wasn't any better back then compared to today. It's not like they went through a massive prison reform. Like they have. Like things are better. They actually have rights in prison now. Right? I'm not saying prison's a cup wake. I still would not want to go a cup walk. Sorry. I saw that. Yeah. Cake walk. Cup walk. I did sleep last night. All right. Too much turkey. All right. We'll get there. Let's not focus on that. All right? But prison was horrible back then. It wasn't a good time. It wasn't relaxing. So what's going on here? Let's look even further. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts, your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, and everything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Are you needing your attitude changed? It is not for anybody else. Like, if your first thoughts are not my attitude, but my husband's or my sister's or my coworkers, I'm going to tell you right now, no, your attitude needs to change if your focus is on somebody else right away. Your attitude needs to change. Because everything outside, if it's determining how you're going to be today, if somebody else is determining how you're going to act today, if somebody else has full control of how you're going to be today, I'm going to tell you right now, God is not in control then. That your attitude is not adjusted for the gratefulness of what God has in store for you. If it's limited to your interactions with people today. Tomorrow, Tuesday. It's recognizing that. You see, in this scenario, there's a lot of people that has put Paul in this situation, and everything he's saying is, listen, because of what I'm doing, I feel no anxiousness. I'm good. I'm at peace. I write you from this good place, not a great place that I'm sitting and residing in, but a good place that I'm residing in. Do you understand that? Man, I want that. You see, I don't want people to be in control of my attitude. I want to be able to walk out, and if somebody says something, does something, I want them to see the gratefulness that has been changed in me. I want them to see an attitude of love and kindness as my response to their ugliness that they have to share. You see, in this world that Paul lives in, he is not bound by this world. He has been freed by Jesus Christ. He may be in prison. He may be having chains on him, but he is the freest man in this world at that point. And he's writing this church that needs to understand their attitude needs to change. You see, he's writing this to them because they're whining, they're complaining, and they're not getting the things that they want, and they're not doing the things that they want. And Paul's in prison going, listen, it's not about that. Has Jesus changed your life? Then believe it and let it change you permanently to have an attitude of gratitude. Let's read some more. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that the last of you renewed in concern for me. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at least you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you are concerned. But you have no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need. I have learned from to be content in whatever circumstances. What if we ask that question? Are you content in every circumstances this morning? What circumstances are you not? Let's put it that. And if you can label them, if you can start to recognize them, guess what? That's an area that you need to learn to be grateful in for what God is doing and what God can do. Maybe it needs a relationship needs to be restored, and it's a one-sided relationship. Be grateful in it that God can restore it. Right? Maybe it's an addiction and a habit that you are dealing with that you have begged God, please take, and it's a thorn in your flesh, just like Paul has requested, and God goes, no, I'm not going to remove that. In fact, through that, my glory is going to be shown even more. And because of that thorn, guess what? People are going to come to know that God loves the imperfection of me, even in the perfection of him. The only way I can be perfect is through the saving grace of Jesus Christ. That's where my perfection is found. Nothing that I can do. But if I'm asking for a habit that needs to be crushed, guess what? My attitude of gratitude that God can and will, and if he doesn't, it doesn't affect me for my attitude because I know what Jesus is doing in me. And I know he will use my imperfection to move his eternity. You understand that? To share it with other people that even though I'm weak, I guarantee you probably have people in your life you look to and go, they got it all together. I wish I could be them. They seem life is perfect. I'm going to tell you right now, it's not. It's a big charade that they've been able to perfect at. Nobody is perfect. Everybody is dealing with issues. It's just reality. Now, some of them deal with it better. Some of them may be able to hide it even better. But that is, first off, we talked about this a few sermons way back. We are not called to hide our imperfections within this church walls. You understand that? We are called to live these imperfections out, to pray for each other, to lift each other up, and understand where our needs are. That's what church is. But man, we try so hard to hide them, don't we? Just me? I want from the outside, look, man, my family's got it together. That we are good. Right? That I'm the best husband that my wife could ever have. Stop laughing. I know. Reality is this. Nobody is perfect. No spouse is perfect. No child is perfect. No grandma is perfect. I'm getting stepping on toes, I know. But I'm going to tell you this. God comes in, and what I love when we invite God in, all we can see is the perfection where God is working. You see, the more that I draw closer to God, the things that annoyed me about my wife go away because my attitude has changed in how I look at her. But it takes me to be closer to God. And it starts to move the things in which I have built up and go, hold on, she needs to change before I change, and she needs to do this before I do this. No, there's not this game anymore. And it wipes it away and goes, okay, I just called to love her. Be a servant of her. You know what Jesus even said? Like, I'm supposed to treat her as Jesus treated the church. Do you know what that means? I'm willing to give my life for her. And I'm going to tell you, there's moments, I guarantee, in my life, I'm like, did you hear? That's not how it goes when I'm closer to God. He starts to flip that switch, and I start to understand this isn't about Ben Alexander and what I want and what I desire. This becomes about God. In these moments, I go, okay, God, use me. And he goes, love your wife. Love your kids. Love your parents. Love your neighbor. Love yourself. Love me. These are not easy things. Especially when we want to be justified, especially when we want to be acknowledged, especially when we want ours, right? Show me that you love me. He already did. He doesn't, like, the reality is he shouldn't have to anymore. This is the amazing thing about God. He still does. He wants to prove it to you how much he loves you. So much that you're overwhelmed. You're like, okay, stop. Stop showing me, because now you want me to be changing. Like, the more I receive God's love, the more that I start to recognize God, the more that I got to be a happy person because I know what God has done. He loves me so much. I want this joy to just fill everything. I can't be, I want to be grumpy. No, I can't, because God loves me. Me. The dirty, rotten scoundrel that needs, that wants, that desires, he loves me. And I didn't have to earn it. Walking out with that understanding, how can I not be grateful, not because of the standings that I have, not because I'm rich in this world, because God has enriched me with his love. He's changed how I see the world. I want you to know, it is easy to wake up in the morning and hate this place. It's easy to find every negative thing about this world. It's easy to go, man, my parents did this to me. It's easy. That's easy. You know what's amazing is when I recognize and God comes to me face to face and goes, I love you despite you. I love you because of what my son has done for you. I love you because I continue to love you, not because of anything you can do. And it comes face to face and you go, okay, I can't do this. I can't earn this. I can only receive this. And in that moment, it changes everything. And if you accept it, if you believe it, if you know it, you cannot help but understand this world from a different perspective from anybody else in this world. You understand God loves you, and that's good. Right where I'm at. And I'm able to give thanks, not because of my circumstances, not because of what I've received in this world, not because of where I sit in this world, not because of my power, not because of who I am, because of what Jesus has done in my life. I'm able to give thanks. And so when things are messy, when things are not easy, can you be Big Tom standing over Timmy knowing that our God is good? Can you understand that Jesus stands over you and know life is good even in the misery of life? Life is good. Even in the brokenness of marriages, life is good. Even in the brokenness of relationships, life is good because God comes in with a desire to restore, a desire to fill that moment. So this week, Psalms 107, stand with me, church, says this. Psalms 107:1 says this, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let me read that again, because I want you to believe it. I want you to know it. I want it to change your attitude. I want it to be something that is restoring you today, tomorrow, that you can depend on, that you know that's there to take your wounds this week, that's there to change your world this week, that's there to love you through the misery of this week and give you an attitude that's going, in this mess, God is good. Why? Because his love endures forever. Psalms 107, live it, breathe it, know it. God, we give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Lord, may we be dismissed in your presence this week. May we know and believe that you've changed us. May we live in this attitude where we can be grateful for not where we are, but where you are. May we know that you've changed our lives. And our situations might not change, but the way we approach them is through you. We give you all the praise. May your love endure forever. Amen. You're dismissed.